joining us today for our last COSI of the quarter. So we host this series every single week with different topics and different facilitators because we believe in the open exchange of ideas and freedom of information. So whether or not you agree with everything you hear in this talk, or you read in one of the books on our shelves, or any of the books up here, which are available for checkout if you'd like to find out more about this topic, we do ask that you're respectful and engage with the facilitator in having an active discussion. So, if you are passionate about a topic and would like to host a session, we have mostly filled up for fall quarter, but come talk to me and I'd be happy to get you on the schedule. So we have students, staff, and faculty members and community members come and host these, and we especially love having students. So we'd love to support the work that you all are doing here, and we'd love to be a space for you all to share some of the work you're doing. At the end of this discussion, I'll ask you to fill out a brief survey telling us what you liked, what you didn't like, how we can improve, because we want this to remain engaging and interesting for you all. So today, join me in welcoming our final COSI speaker of spring quarter, Kraig Schwartz, as we discuss ISIL, is the Islamic State a consequence of U.S. foreign policy? So, Kraig. Hey.
So we only have 50 minutes to go over lots of material, but as I go through it, if you have a question, if there's something you don't understand, raise your hand, okay? So we can make some progress. Now, having said that, let me ask you a question. What's ISIL? You know what ISIL is? What would you say it is?
I would say Islamic State. I would say terrorist state. That's my quotation mark.
Okay, yeah. Right. Anybody else want to take a stab at defining what ISIL is? Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I think like what they say, it's one of the propagandas that the USA are using today to make some changes and to get the benefit of this mess that's going on right now.
Okay. Now, the most important thing that you just told me, the word you used was mess.
Yeah.
Right? And the Middle East is in chaos. It's a mess. Okay? But what I want to make really clear today is that the reason that it's a mess, number one reason for it is mess, is because of U.S. foreign policy, right? U.S. created the chaos, it created the instability, and it created massive levels of violence like the region has never seen before. Now, Obama might go on television and say, we have to fight ISIL, or we have to do this, or we have to do that, because it's in our interest to do so, right? Whose interest? Is it my interest, huh? For my grandchildren to have to go and fight over there? Is that in my interest, okay? Is it in the interest of the American people? And that's what we have to keep in mind when we explore these topics, okay? And ISIL is on the top of a lot of people's minds these days, okay? So let's get started here, okay? So here is the Middle East. Now I will just say that I've always been curious about this region. But one thing is that I had the great opportunity to travel there at the beginning of the Arab Spring in 2011, and I became even more interested in it, okay? So, here we are. Here's the Middle East today, and the activities, the actions, the violence that we're talking about is happening in various places in the Middle East right now, but we're talking about ISIL. And ISIL mostly is a phenomena in eastern Syria, and in northern Iraq, okay? We'll come back and look at some other maps of that, okay? Now, some of you may have heard or seen headlines like this recently. Islamic State video shows beheadings of Egyptian Christians in Libya. The people who are running ISIL are not tolerant of other religions. They're not even tolerant of their co-religionists. They're not tolerant of Shia Muslims, for example, okay? It's a very doctrinaire, puritanical, religious basis to much of what they're doing, but it's also economic because there's chaos here. And you've probably seen lots of headlines like this, or maybe you watch TV this summer when they talked about various journalists that were beheaded and so on and so forth. And then this is really kind of alarming, isn't it, when we realize this. But you know what? I'm alarmed by it. But what's new about it? There's not anything new about it, right? Okay? Violence has been part of that culture particularly intensely in the last 10 or 15 years, okay? The U.S. military, right? The U.S. military killed 150,000 people. Is that violence? Right? And most of those people were what? Were they warriors? They weren't warriors, what were they? They were civilians. They were women and children and old men, okay? So violence is endemic at this point. Now, ISIL wants to create the Islamic State. They want to create the caliphate, okay? Now, you'll see that term a lot. And here's what's going on. Muhammad, right, who died in 632, a long time ago, right? When he died, there was a real problem because the community of believers, the Ummah, they got together after he died and said, who's going to be in charge now, right? Who's going to interpret political questions? Who's going to interpret doctrinaire questions? Who's going to have control over interpretation of the Quran and how it's practiced, okay? And the caliphate, right, the caliph was Muhammad's deputy, right? And Muhammad's deputy, going all the way back to those early years, should be the person who is in charge of all of Islam, right? That he's the leading force. He is the caliph. He's numero uno in the whole world. And from the perspective of the people that are creating the caliphate today, that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to recreate the caliphate in the Middle East, in the area where they live right now, because they see themselves as the center of Islam, and they think that all of Islam, whether it be Indonesians or Malaysians or people in North Africa, particularly in West Africa, in parts of East Africa, they should all take their guidance from this caliph. So they're in the process of trying to create a state along the lines that they thought emerged after the death of Muhammad, okay? That's why you hear this whole emphasis on caliphate. Now, these folks are Wahhabis, Sunni Muslims, right? Anybody know where Wahhabism comes from?
Ibn Wahhab.
Comes from what?
Ibn Wahhab.
Yeah. It comes from Saudi Arabia, okay? Because in the 18th century there was a scholar whose name was Habib, right? And he became a dominant force. But for our purposes here, all you need to know is that Wahhabism is a very conservative, puritanical form of Islam that wants to practice just what the Quran says. It wants to have a society based on Sharia law, and that's basically what, but what you need to keep in mind, it's extremely conservative, and it is the major religious focus in Saudi Arabia, America's great friend, right? Okay? Now, some of you are too young, but you all have heard about what happened on September 11th, right? 2001, right? 19 hijackers took their lives, destroying 3,000 people and causing chaos, right? What can we tell you about those 19 hijackers? 15 of them from Saudi Arabia, and all of them were followers, or were Salafist followers of the Wahhabist tradition, okay? And this causes real problems for the United States, right? Because the people that are killing us, right, are supported by the people that are our friends, right? Now you try to get your arm around that one, and it's kind of funny, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, like you comment about what you said. I mean, and at the same time, Britain, they congratulate the revolution of Wahhabis, this man at that time.
I mean,
it's so interesting that Britain support this man at that time, the ideas of this man from like
1920,
60 years ago, I think. So what the relationship when you see it like this? And at the same time, why USA went to Iraq? I'm not from Saddam Hussein supporters, of course. But why USA went to Iraq when Osama bin Laden was from Saudi Arabia? And the idea spread from there, you know, so.
Right. We're gonna try to get to that, okay?
And you know, I don't mean to assault anyone from Saudi Arabia here, and you know, there's no dictatorship system in the world like Saudi Arabia, you know? I mean, there's no dictatorship system in the world like Saudi Arabia.
Oh, yeah.
So why is USA didn't go to Saudi Arabia instead of go to
Does anybody know the answer? It's a three-letter word.
Islands.
Oil. 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 And more oil. Isn't that it? Huh? Right? Hey, you know what the second biggest crop of foreign exchanges in Iraq? Dates. Right? You know what dates are? Date palms, you know, you eat them, nice sugary fruit. That's their second largest product. If Iraq didn't have any oil, if Saudi Arabia didn't have any oil, and all they were doing was exporting various fruits, do you think we'd have the 7th Fleet there, right? Do you think we'd have bases in Qatar and all these other? Of course not, right? Okay, now, ISIL, or ISIS, Islamic State in Iraq, or Islamic State in the Levant meaning the eastern part of the Mediterranean region, right? Control large parts of northern Iraq and Syria. Its movement is spreading to North Africa, right? And here's what's really key. Help us understand the level of stability here. When the United States invaded Iraq in 2003, one of the first things that they did was they disbanded the Iraqi army, including the entire officer corps of the Iraqi army. There were Baathists, right? They were supporters of political supporters of Saddam Hussein. They sent them away. So what did they do? They sent 40 or 50,000 officers, right, away, right? And every one of those officers knew where large stashes of weapons and money were. These officers, first thing they noticed in 2004 and 5, they started to rob banks, right? And they were opposed to the U.S. invasion. Small bank robberies? No. They got $600 million in one robbery alone. It was just incredible. And everybody now says this is the number one mistake the U.S. made in this occupation, meaning that they should have kept the army in place, tried to work with the officers there, and make sure that everybody had a job. Nobody had a job in the Iraqi army anymore. Hundreds of thousands of soldiers without any jobs, right? But we'll go on. Okay, the U.S. role. Okay. So I'm going to be hard-hitting here. I'm not going to kind of waffle and, you know, mince words and all this kind of stuff. But the reality is, going back to the previous conversation, the United States is an imperialist power. It is the leading imperialist power in the world, okay? And what do I mean when I say that? It uses economic, military, and cultural power, I should say political power, to control or strongly influence the land, labor, and resources of the world, right? Does that mean that the U.S. controls the world in every aspect of everything that happens in the world? No, right? But it tries to influence, right, or control all the major forces that impact U.S. corporations and the U.S. economy, right? And when it can't control, it still tries to have as much influence as possible. It wants a world system to operate under the rules of the United States, okay? And the major thing here, when Obama gets on TV or George Bush gets on TV and talks about American interests, they always think, well, America's interests there, right? They never say it. What if they just say, oil, right? We're just there for the oil, right? Oh, we can't do that. We're a democracy, right? We're nice people. We wouldn't ever do anything like that, right? Okay? Except we killed 150,000 people there. Lest we forget the 3 million people that the United States killed in Vietnam. 3 million, right? That's a lot, right? Okay. If there is no oil in the Middle East, would there be in the U.S.? Okay. Let's take a quick tour of how this all happened. Before oil, before World War I, the Ottoman Empire had been in business for a very long time, since 1300, okay? And it was the dominant power in the Middle East, and most of what we now know as the Levant, Lebanon, Palestine, parts of Syria, parts of Iraq, and Jordan, were under the control of the Ottoman Empire, okay? Now, when World War I happens, the Ottoman Empire sided with Germany, okay? And Germany lost that war, and also their ally, the Ottomans. So the Ottoman Empire completely disappeared. It was the end of an era of empire, right? And all that was left of the Ottoman Empire was what country?
Turkey,
right. That's all that's left, okay? But during World War I, in 1916, Britain and France sat down at the table with a map and divided up the Levant, right? They divided up the entire Eastern Mediterranean region and said, you get part A and you get part B, and this is our prize, right? And it was a major disaster for Arabs in the Middle East. It was also a major disaster that influenced the Iranians as well, okay? And by the way, if you don't know, Iranians are not Arabs, they're Persians, okay? Okay, so here is what the Ottoman Empire looked like in 1878, 40 years before the First World War. So the Ottoman Empire was already well into decline at this period, but you can see they controlled large parts of North Africa, including Egypt, all the way down the Red Sea and along the coast of Saudi Arabia. And in fact, the Ottomans saw themselves as the caliph, right? And they in fact had control over Mecca and Medina, the two holiest cities of Islam. Now, that changed, and they lost more territory, and look at 1912. Ottoman Empire is on the ropes, okay? It's in very difficult shape, but still, they had major influence all the way up to Europe, down through Lebanon. They basically still control Palestine, Jordan, etc. Now, the war happens, and they lose that, and during the war, can't really make it up very well from this map, but this is the Mediterranean here, and the French got part A, and the British got part B. They divided up the Middle East, and they created a mandate system that was put into law by the new League of Nations that happened. But anyway, what does this mean? It means it's European imperialists, not Americans, right, who are deciding the destiny of the people who live there. And not only that, the French and the British, during the war, they made a great promise to the Arabs. You know what the promise was?
Sykes-Picot.
Pardon?
Sykes-Picot. Is it Sykes-Picot agreement or Lausanne?
They said when the war was over, the Arabs regained independence and control over their own lands. And they got totally double-crossed, okay? And those lands came under control of the French and English, and gradually they were given their independence, but great animosity. There's nobody alive now that really sort of remembers what happened in World War I, but it's a strong memory that lives in communities there. It's a strong memory, it's still there. Okay, now,
So were they given that promise because they had helped those Allied forces during the war?
The Arabs were anxious to get rid of Ottoman control. I mean, Ottoman were not exactly nice guys, but it was a relatively sort of benign relationship had been for centuries. Yeah.
I mean, I think at that time France did very well, unlike some other endeavors at that time. They did very well in Syria and Lebanon.
They what?
France, I mean, did very well in Syria and Lebanon, so they were kind of good invaders, like the invaders to destroy, you know, but France did very well.
They treated them well, you mean?
Right.
Yeah, I mean.
Yeah, apparently.
Yeah.
So there are certain aspects of colonial rule that were nice, right? Okay, they brought trains and railroads and stuff like that, and so on and so forth, but they took control of the labor forces and the resources and all that kind of stuff. Okay, now, when World War I is over, we start to move into an era that we can get our arms around a little bit better. Okay, just before and after World War I, massive oil deposits are discovered in various parts of the Middle East, Saudi Arabia, Iraq, Iran, okay. Long-standing conflict in Saudi Arabia between the Wahhabists and other folks led to the creation of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, KSA, still around, right? And I'm not gonna, hopefully not offend anybody, but I will make the statement that as far as I can tell, it is perhaps the most conservative country in the world, a country where women still can't drive, still can't go to university, can't vote, can't go out in the evening without a chaperone, right? That's what I would call a conservative society. But they have lots of oil, and guess who became their best friend during the 1930s? The United States. And that effort was led by Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the liberal that we have put into iconic status over the years, okay? And what did what did the Saudis do? They promoted this Wahhabist version of Sunni Islam, right? Okay? No tolerance for the Shia, no tolerance for Christian communities, etc. Their goal was basically to spread Wahhabism, right? U.S. become great friends. By 1950s, Middle East is the largest producer of oil in the world. And I'm going to skip World War II, but we'll just go forward here. And so what does the U.S. do when World War II is over? Its friend from the war, Soviet Union, became its enemy, right? After all, World War II would not have been successfully won by the Allies had it not been for the Soviet Union. I don't know if you guys know that, but when Berlin fell in 1945, the Soviet Army had 100 divisions of soldiers coming in from the east, and the Americans and the Brits had four. But the Cold War developed very rapidly, and so the United States saw the Soviet Union as encroaching on people's freedom, and so we get something called the Cold War. And part of that Cold War process was that the United States essentially adopted a strategy of befriending anybody in the Middle East that supported U.S. foreign policy, and that mostly meant dictators, okay? And does the U.S. still do this? Absolutely. Test case right now is Egypt. Test case is Egypt. Why? Because Egypt, the Egyptians, turned out the Mubarak regime, right? And elected Mohamed Morsi, who was a conservative Islamist, and he was overthrown by the Egyptian military. And guess who is supporting him now? Huh? No one is supporting Morsi, right? But the generals, right, are supported by the United States. In fact, Obama just created a big deal to send them more military help than that, right? Why? Because, hey, it's our friend, right? It's our friend. I don't care whether they're liberals, conservatives, radicals, as long as they support the U.S. position. That's what counts, okay? Now, during the Cold War, the U.S. developed an alliance system to control the Middle East, to try to, not only to control the oil, but to try to make sure that the Soviet Union, which was to the north, didn't encroach farther down, okay? And it's oil. This country here, which is the largest, most powerful country in the Middle East, Iran. Iran, what's the population of Iran now? 75 million?
76.
Yeah, and the population of Saudi Arabia is maybe 22 million.
28 to 29.
So Iran is a Persian culture, very strong, very powerful. And what you really need to know about Persia and Iran, one of the oldest continuous civilizations in the world, okay? Shares that honor with China. Okay? It's been around for a very, very long time. It's been around different political forms, culturally and intact, and it's way different than some other countries in the Middle East. Now, Iran resists Western control of its oil. In the late 40s and early 50s, the Iranian people did this audacious thing. You know what that was? They said the oil belongs to us, right? This is our oil. This is not your oil, Mr. Churchill. This is not your oil, Mr. Truman, right? This is our oil, right? So what the Iranians did is they had a Shah, right? King and then king, right? But they also had a secular government that was elected by people, right? And they elected a prime minister. His name was Mohammad Mossadegh, right? And Mohammad Mossadegh, you know what he did? He followed the will of the Iranian people and he nationalized all of the oil. What do I mean when I say nationalized? He took it under the control of the Iranian government, right? And seems like a reasonable solution to me, but guess what? The U.S. and Great Britain organized a coup and overthrew Mossadegh and got rid of democratic government in Iran. Okay? Now you heard me right. They got rid of democratic government in Iran and fully supported this guy here, the Shah of Iran. The Shah of Iran, he was a modernizer. He was actually pro-Western. Okay? He supported development programs that were consistent with Western values and stuff like this. But he had major opposition, and you know what he did with his major opposition? He created one of the largest terrorist police regimes in the world called the Sabak, right? And the Sabak killed hundreds and hundreds of political enemies, thousands in prisons, torture and everything like that. And by the time we got to the late 60s and early 70s, the people of Iran, they hated the Shah. They hated the Shah. And this led to a revolution, which we'll get to in a minute, okay? Baghdad Pact, da-da-da. The U.S. is doing all these things to shore things up. But problems developed. Things look up for the U.S. and its allies in the 50s and 60s, stability and dictators, and a bombshell. The Iranian Revolution. The U.S. loses in that one, right? Okay? Now, few in here, maybe a few, remember what happened in 1979, but the Islamic Revolution led by Khomeini came to power. That was very popular. When he came, he had been exiled for France for years and years. When he came to power, heading up this Islamic Revolution, 5 million people showed up in the streets of Tripoli. 5 million, right? They supported it. It was very popular at first. It's become more conservative, but we don't have time to get into all that stuff right now. But the major thing is, when the Iranian Revolution happens, the whole game changes in the Middle East, and it's never been the same since. Why? Because Iran is no longer a U.S. ally, right? And we get lots of instability that happens after 1979. And some of you probably know about the hostage crisis. How many people heard about the hostage crisis? Okay, so we'll just take a 1 minute diversion to show you how inflamed things became. In 1979, during the revolution in Iran, the Iranians did something that's absolutely forbidden by international law. That is, zealous young radicals invaded the U.S. embassy, okay, and captured U.S. personnel, diplomatic personnel, and held them hostage for 444 days, 52 people, right? Total violation of law. But, you know what's kind of interesting? You know what those students did? They occupied the embassy. They kept all those people hostage. You know one of the things they did to pass their time? When the Americans tried to leave, they took all their files and put them in the shredders. The students took all the cases and stuff out of the shredders and put them back together again. Mistaken, right? Okay? And you know what they came up with? They came up with the whole background of what had happened in when their government was overthrown, right? And they had remnant. So they became more and more militant. But this act really isolated Iran politically. Right? You can't do that, you know? But I'm just trying to, you know, shed some light on this, right? So anyway, that's what happens. 79 comes to power. Then Saddam Hussein, he's, you know, relating to this instability, he becomes the dominant person in Iraq. And he goes to war. He wages war against Iran for 8 years, right? Horrible war, between 500,000 and a million people were killed during that war. Why did he do that? He wanted more than the oil fields, right? Saddam Hussein is a secular Sunni Muslim, but he doesn't like the Persians, right? And you know, years later when he was hung, right? When this happened, the last word he said was something to the effect, don't forget the Persians, right? He didn't like the Iranians, okay? But he fought a war. But guess who supported Saddam Hussein in that war? The United States, right? Saddam's best friend, they supported him. Yeah?
I mean, at the same time, when you say he hates Persian at that time, his goal was not only to invade Iran, at the same time, Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is considered a Sunni country. So I think, in my opinion, Saddam Hussein is a dictator, but he was more civilized man, more than all those governments at that time.
Okay,
but
can we take that one up later? Okay. So Saddam comes to power in the 70s, and in the 80s he becomes more and more powerful. His Ba'athist party rules. It's a secular nationalist party. And he was an extreme nationalist. He sort of felt like, hey, you know what, the Middle East, Iraq is our country, and let's get rid of people who don't agree with that, okay? And so he goes to war with Iran, but the thing about Iraq, really interesting, is the majority of people in Iraq are Shia Muslim, right? And we don't have time to go into that distinction today, but if you don't know that, you really need to do, just read up a little bit and find out the difference between Sunni and Shia. They have different interpretations of the Quran, they have different interpretations of the Haditha and some other things, okay? But Iraq has a Shiite majority, right? So the Americans invade, right? Spend 8 years at war, and the Americans actually were forced to leave, right? And when they did, who becomes buddy-buddy? Iraq and Iran, right? So it's kind of interesting, right? This war that was sort of started to make the U.S. more powerful ends up not only creating a relationship between Iraq and Iran that's much, much better, but it basically destabilizes the whole region, okay? So that's the invasion. Iraq falls apart with the U.S. invasion. U.S. disbands the Iraqi army. We've already talked about that, right? Civil war begins. Shia versus Sunni, tribe against tribe. Chaos unfolds all across the country, okay? So I don't know if anybody remembers, you know, for weeks and weeks they had the information about the Battle of Fallujah and all the Marines that got killed there, and the U.S. lost a lot of Marines there, right? Okay? And Fallujah came under U.S. control, and then it was lost again, right? And then the U.S. regained it. Right now, Fallujah is controlled by ISIL, right? Okay? So ISIL fills a vacuum. There's a total political vacuum over the next year, and becomes particularly important with the Arab Spring. Okay? Now, because of the instability from the Iraq War, there's lots of publicity about dictatorships and democracy, and people all over the Middle East start to reject the dictators that have controlled their lives forever. We're talking about Tunisia, we're talking about Egypt, we're talking about Bahrain, okay? We're talking about Libya, we're talking about Iraq. And so what happens is that people all over the Middle East are stirred up. And you get a major revolt. Egypt, right? The Mubarak regime had been in power since 1981, was overthrown, okay? The first one, people in Tunisia overthrew that government. By the way, Tunisia, of all the countries in the Middle East so far, sort of had the best results from the Arab Spring, okay? Libya, the Gaddafi regime was overthrown. Syria, civil war begins, and Syria is just, it's just such great sadness when I think about what's going on in Syria now, because I had the opportunity to be there about 3 weeks before the civil war started. And Syria is a beautiful, beautiful country. It's just, you talk about the traditional, authentic Arab culture, Syria is that, but now it's just blasted to smithereens and you get to that. So, hang on just a second. So, this is all happening at the same time that the Iraq war ends, right? And the U.S. packs up most of its soldiers and go home, and there's conflict throughout the region, and ISIL emerges, right? And why is ISIL emerging? Because there's a vacuum, there's chaos everywhere, but it's also because the caliphate, right, is essentially trying to reorganize their society, right, based on what they see as Islamic principles, and it's also, as you know, it's very anti-Western, okay? Right, so this is a map of the region today, and see if we can draw this a little bit. This is Syria, right? This is Iraq, okay? The gray areas here, that gray or that light purple, whatever, okay? That is, those are the areas that are under control of the Islamic State right now, okay? And what they're trying to do is consolidate power, defend their borders, and over a long period of time, their vision is that they will become the new caliphate, to which the whole Islamic world will look up to, okay? Now, that's kind of the basics. And now if you look at this here, ISIL over here, we got some real interesting problems because there's a civil war going on in Syria, right? And it's a very complicated alliance system, but that's essentially what's going on with ISIL right now. Okay? And the rogue state along two rivers.
Kraig, I mean, it seems to me that one thing you haven't mentioned yet is the role of Saudi Arabia and Qatar in funding ISIS. It starts with mercenaries in Syria, but they're all funded by the Saudis and the Qataris.
We're going to get to this. Okay? So, headlines, these have been, I just did some screenshots of some headlines in the papers. ISIS stages attacks in Iraq and Libya, despite U.S. airstrikes. The U.S. so far has just been supporting forces against ISIL with their aircraft. Lots of targeted airstrikes all over the region.
Can I ask you something? What's the difference between ISIS and ISIL?
Pardon?
What's the difference between ISIS and ISIL?
You know what? There's no difference. Difference in name, right?
So the answer is right.
One says Islamic State in Iraq, right? I mean in Syria, and the other one is Islamic State in the Levant, the region. So those terms can be used interchangeably. Okay. All right. Now this is a map here. Here's the Islamic State, right? Right now, the red area here in northern Iraq and Syria. And the yellow areas are areas where they have established ties with other organizations that are going to be subalterns to Islam. So they've got people in Libya, they've got people in northern Algeria, they've got people all the way down in Nigeria, they've got supporters in Jordan and Saudi Arabia. Okay? So that's their goal, is to strengthen this and go forward. Okay? Now, calm down. ISIS isn't winning. This is an interesting headline because everybody seems to be, in the West, seems to be worried that ISIS might win or ISIL might win and they're going to crawl in their bedroom windows at night and kill us or something. I don't know. It's sort of instilling that sense of fear. But and as far as I know, they haven't made any kind of pronouncements to that effect. Now, last week, U.S. commanders did a raid on ISIS and got all kinds of intelligence information and so on and so forth. And here we go, the last slide. We can talk for a few more minutes and take a few more questions, right? In shift, U.S. will send 450 advisors to help Iraq fight ISIS, right? Now here's the deal. Obama has been resisting the notion that the U.S. should get involved in another ground war in the Middle East, okay? People like John McCain and Lindsey Graham have sort of leading the charge. Let's go in there, let's go get them, right? And Obama's been very careful, and so he's finally starting to cave into that pressure. So we right now, as we speak, U.S. is building a new military base in Iraq. 450 soldiers are going to be advisors, and there's a shadow plan to send 3,000 more, right? You know how that goes, right? 2,000 now, 3,000 next month, and 3,000 after that. So the U.S. is making a commitment to stop ISIS. And why are they doing it? Because the U.S. is desperate. It's trying to figure out how to gain control over a region that it once had in its hip pocket. That's what it's trying to do. And it is going to be a terrible, terrible mess. And I'm not going to suggest exactly what we should do about it, but for one thing, that Richard over here, my colleague, mentioned Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia was having a real serious problem. You know why? Because half of the people in the leadership in the Saudi royal family, right, half of those people, and a lot of people, even in the clergy in Saudi Arabia now, are saying, ISIL's cool. Let's support ISIL, right? Why shouldn't we? After all, it's fulfilling the ideals that we talked about for 1,000 years, and finally somebody's showing up to do something about it. That is to create a strong anti-Western Islamic state, okay? And they are funding, Saudi Arabia is funding all kinds of militias and rebels that are involved in this, and Saudi Arabia is doing some other stuff all over the world, particularly in the Islamic world, right? It doesn't make the news very much, but if you read the papers about Pakistan, or if you read the papers about India, occasionally you'll see a new article that will say a mosque was blown up in some place in Pakistan and 39 people died, right? I guarantee you almost every one of those mosques is blown up with that kind of mosque. Shia mosque, right? Okay? But Saudi Arabia has got this strong, strong current. It's working very, very hard to try to create a purified region, right? For the world, and a lot of people think that. Now, this thing is beyond Saudi Arabia. There's a civil war going on in Syria. Civil war in Syria has at least four sides, right? At least four sides that sometimes fight with each other, sometimes fight against each other. Iraq basically has fallen apart because Iraq has got a fundamental problem. It wants to be a nation, right? But it can't be a nation because there isn't strong national identity about what it means to be Iraqi, right? Iraq is basically divided between Kurdish people, right? Sunni Arab Muslims and Arab Shia, very strongly divided. Why is that important? Because when your allegiance goes to your family or goes to your tribe, it's hard to get people to transfer that to national allegiance, particularly when the last two governments in Iraq have been Shia Muslim, right? And the U.S. was hoping that these new Shia governments would do what? bring people together and be nice to the Sunnis, right? And partial government jobs to them and bring them into the officer corps. In fact, just the opposite happened, right? The new governments that have been in Iraq, guess what they've been doing? They've given all the jobs to Shia, right? And so on and so forth. And we can't really sort out, but it's very complicated. At this point, the U.S. unwittingly, and George Bush bears strong responsibility for this. As far as I'm concerned, personally, George Bush should be in prison. He's a war criminal, right? He's the guy that started this, right? It was his notion. Why did he do this? Why did the U.S. invade Iraq? Why? Weapons of mass destruction, right? Well, there were no weapons of mass destruction, right? Well, then we had to come up with other reasons. Why did we get rid of Saddam, okay? When the U.S. got rid of Saddam, and they got rid of what? They completely destabilized. So what's going to happen? Some people are saying, here's some of the scenario. Iraq is going to get divided into three different countries, right? Another scenario is that ISIL, in fact, will be successful and create a new Islamic state in northern Iraq and Syria, and this message will spread throughout the world. That's another scenario, right? Now, the real idealists, though, would say, well, what we got to do is we just got to try harder to get Iraq to be a modern nation state. Those people have some common identity, what it means to be about Iraq, so they're willing to fight. Did you see the statement a couple weeks ago by the U.S. Defense Secretary about Iraq? He said Iraq, they can't fight, right? Why? Because they're not into it, right? They're not into it because they're fighting for the Iraqi state is way different than fighting for your tribe. Right? Okay, so I don't know where this is going to go, but all I can tell you is you should pay attention to the news and watch it, right? And there's going to be all kinds of attempts by the Obama administration and the next administration to convince you that it's in your interest to support another ground war in the Middle East. And a ground war that the U.S. will get involved with is a ground war that the U.S. helped create. Now, that doesn't mean we take responsibility away for ISIL and criminals who are, in some cases, running that organization. Hey, we have to stop, we have to figure out ways to deal with that kind of stuff, but it is a total mess. Yeah. Any questions? Yeah?
I mean, it's like, it's so interesting.
Can you pick up a little bit?
It's interesting. By the way, I don't support any scientists. Not USA, not Russia, and not uh-huh. I like to be independent for myself, but at the same time, when Osama bin Laden fought Russia at that time, we know that he was supported by USA, and he was getting the funding not from his pocket, but from USA and South Arabia. And he used weapons, US weapons at that time. And like what you said, USA replaced civilized governments, and they put instead of them those wrong versions of Islamic systems, you know? At the same time today, they say that ISIS is getting funds from American banks, statements from American banks. They end up getting money from their pockets also. So
I don't know about that specific, but they're getting money from lots of people, including the Saudis, right?
Yeah.
Qatar and all kinds. Yeah, all the Gulf states are getting from Kuwait.
From USA friends or USA, right. That's what I mean. So it's like
what's going on, you know. I sort of figured if the US was really into it, the first thing they ought to do is bomb Riyadh.
Yeah.
Right? They ought to bomb Riyadh, and then they ought to take out Qatar, and they ought to take out a few of the other Gulf states, because those are the sources of this problem. And so the US is just in this terrible, terrible conundrum, right? Because they want to get rid of ISIL, but ISIL is supported now as an ally, so it's just totally crazy. Yeah.
It's not only Saudi Arabia. I mean, if you come from Kurdistan, Iraq, so the only victim in this area is we Kurdish people. We had no problem all of a sudden by some government or by some people, ISIS being pushed back to Kurdistan and attacked, but they couldn't, they failed. So this is not only Saudi Arabia, and also you have Turkey, great allies, ISIS ally, and also you have Qatar. Qatar is like one of the terrorist countries in the world. So what happened, those ISIS members, like who they get injured or they kill, they go to Turkey to get healed. And they come back right to the war. Mm-hmm. So I don't know, they know the victims we...
Thanks for bringing Turkey into the third
right,
war.
Yeah.
Turkey also, by the way, is a NATO member. It's an ally of the United States, right? So the whole thing is just really crazy, and I appreciate you bringing that into the discussion. Richard.
I think it's worth considering that the point is the chaos.
The what?
That maybe the point is chaos. That U.S. foreign policy is not after peace, it's after chaos. And because really the neoconservative philosophy is that you should have permanent war. And societies need wars. And so Rumsfeld and Cheney, they want to create endless war. They didn't want to create endless peace. So to look at it and say, well, the US is messing it up because there's chaos, I think that's just misunderstanding US policy. It's chaos because that's the policy.
You know what? I mean, yeah, I've read all those neocon and I appreciate that, but if that is the policy, I'm not convinced it is the policy, but it might be the policy. If it is, it's a pretty high risk. It's a pretty high risk.
Well, they're horrible people, so
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
There might be
fine.
They're willing to kill millions.
And Cheney should be in prison, but Bush should be in the same cell. Yeah.
Well, a question that comes up for me is each of these soldiers that are in these different little, you know, armies. If they were able to make a choice for themselves whether they wanted to be at war, would they have that choice or they have to do it because it's part of their religion? I mean, is it basically they're motivated strictly by their religion and they have to stick with those people, or they'll be killed by them for not fighting?
Or do
they have the choice to walk away?
I like that. That's a really good question, okay? Now, I think it would really be a mistake to think this is all about religion. I don't think it's about religion, but it's certainly about ethnic and class conflict, and religion plays a very important role, right? So, for example, this gentleman just here, you're a Kurdish, right?
Yeah.
And the Kurdish are Sunni Muslims, right? Okay. Well, Sunni Muslims in Kurdistan, right, they're way different than Arab Sunnis in terms of where they practice. So there are these kind of differences, right? And I don't see these soldiers very often thinking, you know, I'm fighting for my religion so much today as I'm fighting for my ethnic identity. I'm fighting for my Kurdish brothers and sisters, or I'm fighting with my Shia Arab brothers and sisters. And it's really kind of hard to sort it out. So I don't think we can just simply say it's religion or it's politics.
Well,
it's
my question was really more whether they have the choice to walk away.
They
have a choice to say, oh, I don't
want to
be anymore, I'll go somewhere else, or I'll go
live
with another
tribe. I think a lot of people do walk away, right? And a lot of people hang in there depending on how vested they are in this thing. But the thing is that there is so much chaos. There is just so much chaos in the region that it gives rise to ISIL, right? Because, look, here's what ISIL offers to people. It offers answers, right? And what their answer is that we're gonna build a peaceful Islamic society. Just hang out and wait a while, right? And I can see why that's really appealing, right? I mean, somebody must like ISIL. Why are hundreds and if not thousands of young Europeans, including Americans and Canadians, going there to fight, right? Why are a lot of villages throughout that entire region supportive of ISIL, right? It's not so much they don't glorify the beheadings and stuff like that, but they want stability and control over their lives and control over their community and with their jobs to work and make money. That's gonna be a long time before this thing gets sorted out. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I've got two questions.
Yeah.
The first one is, in your opinion, where change will come from when it comes to the Middle East? Should it come from the ruling classes, or should it come from people already oppressed for, let's say, 1,000 years now, if you don't count the Ottomans and others? And my second question, which I want you to answer first, is how can you explain 30,000 Armstrong, like that ISIL, showing up on the
Showing up where?
Out of the blue, nobody saw them coming, which is quite suspicious, because they were, seriously it is, they just showed up within one night. You woke up the next morning, 30,000 strong over there, they've sacked a lot of cities in Syria and Iraq. They took down one of the Iraqi cities over there within 4 days. Supposedly the allies were protecting the Iraqi army with the airstrikes, but apparently the airstrikes were doing ISIL good, and the Iraqi army over there.
Well, I don't have a good answer for that question, but I do think that one of the problems is that the CIA and, you know, British intelligence and French intelligence and all these people, you know, they're looking under the wrong rocks, right? They're not paying attention to the big picture. And ISIL, right, basically totally outmaneuvered all these large imperialist powers, right? They were able to keep people hid and prepared. And when they got to work, it was, remember last summer when we first started to hear of ISIL, right? What you're saying is that they just appeared out of the woodwork. Well, they weren't out of the woodwork. They've been organizing for years and years, and the Iraqi officer corps was involved and a whole bunch of other people. I don't know the details of that, but I'm sure you're right. It sure was a surprise. But I think it's just basically I think there's another part to it is that the U.S. doesn't think that people without tanks and airplanes and stuff like that can be successful, right? Because the U.S. sort of looks at, well, you know, we're superior, and we can do everything. Well, the Vietnamese totally disproved that, right? And the U.S. sort of forgot. What was your first question? I forgot about it.
The change, where you think should come from?
The change is going to have to come from the people that live there. It's going to have to come from the working classes. It's going to have to come from the people that are suffering the most in this situation. Because if ruling class forces take over, come up with a compromise, that's what the U.S. is working on right now. They're going to do the same damn thing they've been doing since World War II, putting dictators in power, right, who abuse the human rights of the people who live there until they've had enough, and then we get the Arab Spring.
So if they did want to leave and go someplace else, where would they go? I mean, the U.S. won't even let the translators from the Iraq War immigrate here. I mean, where would they go if they wanted just to not be involved in the war?
They're going to have to go to Turkey, right? Or hopefully the situation stabilizes enough that they can return to their own communities. But right now that looks very difficult. And I don't know if you noticed the press in the last couple of days that the world migration crisis faces right now is, I think, it's one of the worst times it's been since World War II. I mean, people in Indonesia, and Malaysia, and Myanmar, and I think in Syria now, more than 10% of the population has left Syria. Another 10 to 15% are internally displaced, right? Libya's in total chaos right now. So, I don't know, it's a very difficult situation, but all I want to leave you with is keep in mind who created it. Not completely, but if you look at the end of the world, it means total humanitarian disaster. Thanks.
Do you think if Saddam Hussein was there until today, do you think that ISIS might appear?
Good question. I don't know how to answer that one, but that's a good question. Yeah.
Do you think I wondered recently that there were some threats that some of those people are coming over to our
I don't know. Does anybody have any information on that?
Hey, what's the question?
It was in the news. Yeah, he was very smart because, you know, when Bush was president, he said, go out and shop.
I hope that's not true, but your question raises a real serious problem for our democracy, right? Because if it is true, what it means is we're going to get Patriot Act 2, we're going to get Patriot Act 3, and we're going to have a police state. It's going to be more difficult. Right? But how do we solve the problem? Pay attention to the news, right? Don't let the U.S. get involved in the military. Demand from your congresspeople, et cetera, that the U.S. should not fight another combat war anymore.